Thanks, I had to restart my computer anyway because it wasn't pushing the content, so we're even. All right, cool, thank you. All right, let's start with our quote today. So, Nicholas, do you want to read that?
Thanks to television, for the first time, the young are saying history made before it is censored by their elders. Margaret Mead.
Okay. Do you know who Margaret Mead is? No?
I recognize the name, but it's not ringing a bell.
Yeah. She was a famous anthropologist who worked in Asia after World War II, and she wrote a book on Japan and the Japanese culture that served as probably the basis of most of the information and the understanding that the United States had about the culture of Japan at the time. So, a very famous anthropologist, sociologist. So, what do you think of the quote?
I think it's a good quote, but depends on what year is this.
Well, this is contemporary to what we're studying. So, right as the rise of television is coming in.
If we could have just skipped that, that would have been a lot better.
What do you think, Nicholas?
I think it was true for the time, but not so much anymore with how biased the different newscast systems are.
Ah, okay. So do both of you see a bias in media?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
I do.
Okay.
Definitely.
Do you think that it's a ubiquitous bias? Is it slanting one way or the other?
Yeah, like, seems like, you know, like, there's Fox News, Drudge Report, you know, it's like people went from, like, just being, you know, Republican or being right-wing to now they're, like, way over there, like, around the corner right-wing.
Okay.
It's, I don't know, become a hot mess. Obviously, in the Republican lately. I mean, Democrats have their own share of problems too, but.
Okay. So you see a difference in the different medias where they slant one way or the other. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yes, because like Fox News, they always say that they're, that they're impartial, and you know they're gonna let you make up your mind. But everything they do is, you know, Obama is the devil, you know, and then, you know, everything's Republican. Nothing, you never hear anything from the Democratic view on their show.
Okay. So is there anything that counters that? Is there another media service that counters that?
I think MSNBC. Counter it, but not as bad. But
okay.
I think they do counter it a little bit.
What about you, Nicholas?
CNN. What about you?
I'm sure there is news that counters it, but I'm not up to date with different news and different ideals.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know exactly which one.
Okay. But both of you agree that there is a bias in the media, in the information that you're getting.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. All right. So, censoring with the media, and we've seen censoring or not necessarily, they, of course, wouldn't necessarily call it censoring, but there were definite stories that were published, you know. Thomas Jefferson would publish certain stories that would show his opponent in a poor light. And so it's nothing new, and you saw, Nicholas, you didn't get the advantage of reading some of the newspapers. I do have some of those old newspapers that you can read. They are really fascinating because they are definitely opinionated. Like, every article is an opinion. It's really cool to read because they're unabashedly opinionated. Today, in today's society, unless it's in an opinion piece, you don't necessarily get that viewpoint that it is an opinion, but the bias that's coming through does show some opinion, right? So, let's see. Censored. There are some media outlets that you can get that aren't as censored. Obviously, when you go to China, it's quite censored. But Facebook, you know, even though there are censors on Facebook, the information still gets out. Twitter, think of the Arab Spring and some of the things that the young were seeing before it was censored. And the old. The young and the old. Okay, does that make sense? Okay.
Yeah. All right. And Nicholas, I explained to Robin the reason there's no lecture up on in Blackboard is because neither one of you were able to attend, and so there was no class on Tuesday.
So I want to go back to this map here of post-war division of Europe. Okay, now I want you to pay attention to the lines here that they're drawing, of the Iron Curtain, right? East Germany, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, Albania, which is off on the coast of the Adriatic, and then Finland up there near the border between Russia and Finland, or the Soviet Union and Finland. So if you look in today's world, sorry, pushed the wrong button. Okay, if you look in today's world, this was in 09 when we were driving through. This is now the border between East and West Germany. And we're coming from the East, okay? We had spent a lot of time in East Germany, like a couple kilometers from the border of the Ukraine, East Germany. Poland. We were way far over, right? And so you have these sections here, and this, you can't see it because of the trees and the light posts now, but there were probably 10 stalls across that you would funnel through, vehicles would funnel through. Today they just had it down to one, and you didn't have to stop. Now some of the borders you had to stop, not as many because of the EU. Right? We didn't have to stop in as many. We did have to stop in Switzerland. Coming out of Switzerland. This is a rest area right past that East-West German border. And this is looking from the West Germany side. So you cross this border. Look back here. Okay? You've got like a two-lane. They have it narrowed down to a two-lane. And it only had widened out right there, right? And you look at the Autobahn on the West German side. Okay, well, here are some castle ruins on the edge of the German border from the West German side, what is now all Germany, but what used to be the West German side. But as you're driving from East Germany to West Germany, and this has probably changed by now because the infrastructure, the work that they were doing was amazing. They were dumping billions of dollars into infrastructure, highway projects galore, everywhere, right? But you go from a two-lane highway and older type highway, you get to what is considered, what used to be considered West Germany, and it's a super highway. I mean, wide, newly paved Autobahn, you know, 100 miles an hour or more. So this is the Slovakia-Hungary border coming from Hungary. So you can see where they had a few stalls there. What they do now is they just route you around it. So you don't have to stop and you don't have to go under that, those stalls there. Okay, this is the same one just showing where this car is. You can see also, though, that it does have, these have all been left, right? I mean, the communism fell in 1990. And these have all been left in place as of 2009. And you can see the gate that comes down right next to that little red car. And then we were in the Czech Republic, and here are some of the armaments in the Czech Republic, okay, from the Cold War era. Pretty fascinating. You go through these countries and you see these things, and it's, you know, just out of the blue, you come across the armaments. And here's the current, or the 09 Slovakia, Polish border, as we're heading north into Poland from Slovakia, which, by the way, is an incredibly beautiful, reminiscent of Alaska country. Brilliant water. It's really stunning. But you can see again where they have taken the border and they're routing you around it, but yet they're keeping that in place. Okay. Any questions? Okay. All right. So, Korean War. And, you know, it's not quite laughable, but it's ironic that the Korean War, the Forgotten War is what they call it, is just such a small... Oh, did he? Yeah.
Yeah, my dad's dad. And we didn't even know that he was ever in the military until he passed away, and we're like, we found his suit and everything.
Yeah, so he...
To find all that.
Yeah, so he never talked about it.
Nope, not a word.
Mm-mm. No, not uncommon. So it was Korea that he was in?
Yep.
Okay. All right.
Sounds like that was the only one that he fought into.
Yeah. So, Korea, as they're dividing it on the 38th parallel, which you can see in the background, the picture is of the 38th parallel. Japan had controlled Korea since 1904. Remember, Japan and their aggression had gone through and they had controlled it. So, North Korea, as they're dividing Korea, okay, North Korea is supported by whom? Which country is supporting North Korea?
China. Actually, my brother was stationed there, too, in the demilitarized zone, the DMZ.
Yeah. Okay.
Isn't China backing them, or Russia?
Russia. Yeah. China was involved. You know, China wasn't going to let them come in, but the USSR was doing a lot of that support because of the communism. They wanted to implement the communism, remember? And they wanted to really kind of temper the American influence in Asia. So it was called the Democratic People's Republic of Korea. And South Korea is called the Republic of Korea. What's that?
The DPRK. That's what they call it now, too.
Yes. Yes, it is.
Yeah.
So, both were claiming the sole right to rule Korea, right? So the U.S. is backing the South Koreans, and USSR is backing the North Koreans, right? So in 1950, in June of 1950, North Korean troops attacked South Korea, right? Now, Korea, because of its history and because of its place in the world, the United States was like, this is the Greece of the Far East, okay? If we let Korea fall, communism is just going to keep infiltrating the rest of the Asian nations, okay? We can't let Korea fall. And remember how much money they pumped into Greece and Turkey?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, tons of money, right? So, also the year going on, Kennan's containment policy, where you need to stand up against Russia and not let them bulldoze through each of these countries, and to and in theory they would back down, right? So as we had lost China because Chiang Kai-shek and that, we lost China, we sold out in Eastern Europe. Truman is taking charge, and he's trying to hold the line in Korea, okay? Because he's already lost China, and he's lost Eastern Europe. In this is the perception, right? And so as Truman is dealing with this, he actually sends the military in before going to Congress. Now, who is the only group or person in the United States who can declare war?
President.
Nope.
Congress.
The Senate.
Senate.
Yeah. You're getting there.
Right.
Okay, so the Senate was not utilized. So the Senate comes back and says, hey, you can't do that. Truman said, I'm asking the UN to help repel this invasion by North Korea. Okay? Get the United Nations in this police action to restore the border. Okay? And so what they do is... they send in ground troops under General Douglas MacArthur. Now, MacArthur, being MacArthur, doesn't want a limited war, okay? Truman wants to negotiate. He doesn't want to go for an all-out war. MacArthur goes in and says, we're not going to win this if we don't go to war. And he and Truman lock horns multiple times. And what happens to MacArthur? Truman fires him because he is publicly going against Truman. Truman wants to hold the line, okay? He wants MacArthur to back down. MacArthur won't back down. He fires MacArthur. The public actually was backing MacArthur, okay? So the public didn't want a limited war. Nobody had ever fought a limited war before. The public didn't understand a limited war, and they didn't want to fight a limited war. They were with MacArthur. So, as MacArthur, before this, MacArthur had become an aggressor. I mean, he was fighting a war. So, in an aggressive stance, he was going to liberate Korea. So he went north, and he and China had said, "You cannot advance into China." And he got to the border, and Chinese came in and fought him all the way back, almost to the base of Korea. He was able to pull it back out and come in on the flank, okay? But it was a huge military defeat to be forced all the way from the northern border to the southern shore, right? And so Truman decides with the fact that MacArthur just isn't going to do negotiations, we're going to, I'm going to fire him. So in 53, we come to an armistice, okay? However, this armistice, and so that was in 50, right? When we went in. 53, we come to an armistice. There were carpet bombs in the north. So they were using some of the same tactics that had been used in World War II, that the Germans had used, the British had used, the Americans had used. Okay, so you carpet bomb the north and try to get the people to support the other side. There were millions of civilian casualties with the carpet bombing, okay, in the north. And so with the armistice, it fell right about the same, it fell on the same line. I mean, they had fought back and forth and ended up in the same spot. So the limited war limited the response, although there were hundreds of thousands who did die in that war. The outcome of the war, regardless of the armistice, was that it preserved the line, right? But in addition to that, it preserved the balance of power in Asia. So the United States didn't gain any more power, and the Russians didn't really gain any more power. They ended up pretty much status quo, okay? But it expanded the power of the executive again, because he got around the requirement for Congress to put troops in somewhere by saying, we're going to ask the UN for a peacekeeping mission, you know, a non-aggressive mission here. Okay, so this was, these had dramatic effects in how we dealt with, how we will deal with in the future from the 50s to today, how we will deal with nations, aggressive nations today. Okay? So you can see some of these offenses. So you have the North Korean offensive coming down. You've got the UN offensive. So MacArthur is taking these UN troops. But then look at that counteroffensive from China. And they're also using Russian materials too. As they're coming down, see how far down they push them? And then MacArthur pulls an amphibious retreat and pulls into the flank, okay? And then goes back up. But some of these areas were just brutal. I mean, really brutal, especially near Incheon. And there were quite a few different spots. So this picture here is the convoy of U.S. Army trucks crossing the 38th during the war. And then this one is the Korean War Memorial, one of the newest memorials in Washington, D.C. And when you show this, like I took these pictures, I took a lot of these pictures from the memorial because my friend Wayne hasn't been there to see it, right? And he looked at it and he's like, wow. He said, this is so realistic because he said, we lived in our ponchos. There, we did everything in our ponchos. So in this memorial, you have these guys walking through these, what would be fields, right? To represent fields, wearing these ponchos. And you have blacks and whites. This was the first interracial, these were the first interracial units, right? And so you can see the radio guys and that as they're making their way through the fields. And then this is another part of it. They kind of emulate the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. They didn't put names on here, but they put these pictures. They etched in the faces of some of the troops from the Korean War. So it's really pretty powerful because you can see there are so many people. And as you walk down this line, I mean, it's huge too. You know, it's quite large. So as you walk down, you look at these pictures and you might pick one or two out that kind of resonate with you. And you think, you know, what's the story with this one? What did this soldier do? And what did his family do? And did this soldier make it back? Right? So those are some of the things that at least I think of as I'm going through these different memorials. And then as we are expanding, we also have these U.S. military installations, and Robin, I think the one that you mentioned is not on this list. These are just some of the U.S. military installations that we have. And, I mean, you look at Honduras, you're like, well, where is it in Honduras? Where do we have a military installation in Honduras or Oman or Qatar? And
my brother was in, he's stationed also in Iraq and then Kuwait and then Qatar. They would go for the vacation. Mm-hmm. They were, you know, fighting in Iraq. Maybe he'd go get like pedicures and stuff in Qatar.
Yeah. Well, we went to this restaurant called Fat Burger. Have either of you been there?
Love Fat Burger.
Okay. Well, on their cups, they have a list of all these different places where they are. And I'm looking at this list, and I had just gone through these military installation lists. And, you know, you're like, well, how can you have a Fat Burger in Qatar? Right? So I'm assuming that they're on these bases in these different places. You know, to Djibouti. I mean, how do you get into Djibouti, right? Unless you're on a military base. So these are some of the U.S. military installations. There are a lot of nations, other nations in the world, who have overseas military installations as well. China does, France does, Germany, India has military installations. Italy, Japan, Russia, Turkey has military installations overseas, and the UK. Okay? And those are just the ones that I had, and the list, of course, is, I'm sure is incomplete because some of them are probably not known. And they could change Australia. Periodically. What's that?
Australia.
Yes.
Oh, there it is, okay.
Yep. So, Truman, his domestic program, he really wanted no experiments. We had gone through so much during this time and with the New Deal and with World War II that his whole policy was no experiments. His one major domestic accomplishment was the Employment Act of 46. Okay? So he could ensure economic growth. So he established this Council of Economic Advisors who could maintain employment through policies, right? Or maintain production or purchasing power. Okay? So the inflation was going to be the chief economic problem. And that meant that the demand was greater than the supply. So that means higher prices, which means inflation. Okay? And Congress at this time had actually made it worse. So the Office of Price Administration held the line on price controls, but retailers were really opposing it, right? So they are trying to extend the price controls, but it's in a weakened form. So you've got these price controls that are now out of the price control, that like they've stopped, and food costs rose 16% in a week. So they had to come back and say, okay, we need to stop this again, right? So it was lifted right before the midterm elections so sellers could provide more goods, okay? And what else on the domestic program? Well, in 46, 25 governorships went to Republicans. So you see this, again, you see this shift. You know, we seem to shift back and forth between the Democrat and the Republican side. And at this time, this was the first time since 28 that the Republicans had held both, that we see the Republicans holding both houses in Congress. Okay? So the Congress, the election of 46 comes in. In 47, you have the Taft-Hartley Act, which barred the closed shop, the unions. Okay? So you no longer had to join a union to work somewhere. Okay? Where the closed shop is where all employees must join a union. And so it eliminated that. Okay? And it outlawed secondary boycotts. And the president could call for a cooling off period, okay? So as this comes in, it's now weakening organized labor as a force, right? So you see, it gained power, organized labor gained power during the New Deal, and now it's being reversed, okay? Or at least weakened. And so Truman, he vetoed it, but he was overridden. And the Fair Deal, if you think about the Fair Deal, you've got a vast liberal agenda where a lot of civil rights were included, national health care, federal aid for education. You know, but you go back and you're like, wait a minute, national health care. So this isn't something new that we've now just passed. This has been brewing at least since the 40s, right? It had been kicked around, but the Fair Deal was actually trying to implement that, okay? And so by 1950, Truman's domestic issues were being superseded by all of the foreign issues. Okay, so here's a map just of the election of 48, where you have Truman versus Dewey. And the electoral vote is dramatically different, but the popular vote is much closer. Okay, and Strom Thurmond actually was the longest serving member He was the longest serving member in Congress, 48 years. Okay, from 1954 to 2002, he was 100 years old when he died. He was still in Congress. I don't remember if he was in Congress when he was 100, but he was definitely in his 90s when he was still in Congress. It was pretty amazing. Okay, so you've got another Red Scare. You've got loyalty and security, the anti-communist crusade. So you have China that fell to communism. You have North Korea, communist. Okay. You've had Russia, who is ramping up. And so there's a lot of tension. There's a lot of fear throughout the United States. Okay. And this Red Scare was longer and deeper than the first Red Scare of 1919 to 20, okay? This is where you see the House Committee on Un-American Activities, right? Where in 1938 they're trying to ferret out the fascists, okay? where you would have the U.S. Communist Party. There were 80,000 members of the Communist Party in World War II. So it was pretty popular in the United States. It wasn't, you know, the number one party, but 80,000 members is nothing to sneeze at. Right? So if you have that many people, and they're all over the nation, and you have the communists winning or taking over China and North Korea, you have people who say, well, hey, we don't want the communists to take over the United States, right? And then you have classified documents stolen from government offices. Is that similar to WikiLeaks?
Yes, I think so.
Yeah, I mean, they're documents, right? Do either of you know which documents were released or made public most recently? These were released to the media a year ago. But which ones were just released?
Which ones were just released? We did the indictment or the emails from Hillary? Or the NSA one? Or the NSA?
The Panama Papers.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's a juicy one.
Nicholas, do you know about the Panama Papers?
Sorry, it was mute. But no, this is the first time hearing about them.
Okay. The Panama Papers came out on WikiLeaks, and they are naming, they're naming a law firm in Panama that's a shell corporation for a lot of heads of state, like the Prime Minister of Iceland. They have called for his resignation because he has these offshore accounts linked to this law firm in Panama that, you know, is supplying this shell corporation to set these up. And basically, when you have offshore accounts, the first thing that people think of is, one, fraud and conspiracy, right? Because you're hiding money. Basically, you're hiding money. Millions of dollars of money, right? And so...
You could just have a crazy accident. You're hiding money because you're getting divorced or something.
Yes, you could. But when you're the Prime Minister of a state, or, you know, the president of a nation, that makes people a lot more nervous.
Right.
And so, Canada, you know, major spy networks were up and running in the United States, in Canada, in the Soviet Union. It was shown that atomic secrets were being passed to the Soviets. There were some, like Alger Hiss, remember Alger Hiss? Okay. Some they were able to find and to actually prove, but some of them they couldn't technically prove until 90, when the communist bloc fell. Okay. And then they started going through some of these papers and realized how much information had been passed. Okay. So yeah, you've got that fine line between conspiracy theory and they're not quite all crazy conspiracy theories, right? Because there are things that are being done, especially passing atomic secrets to the Soviets. So Executive Order 9835 tried to curb that by mandating a federal employee loyalty program. So you had to agree to this loyalty, you had to sign these agreements, these loyalty agreements, right? And Attorney General was keeping a list of subversive organizations, kind of like the IRS was, well, maybe not quite so, but The IRS kind of...
My current event last semester had that tied into it. If you remember the loyalty program?
Yes.
They still use it today. They're using it in Afghanistan.
I believe it. I didn't realize that they were using that with troops. So, if there was any kind of criticism of foreign policy, or if some said, if you looked at an apple pie, or if you didn't like apple pie and didn't eat apple pie, you were going to sign the loyalty agreement because you didn't want to be seen as communist, right? So there was this big anti-communist crusade throughout the United States. And these loyalty probes, of course, promoted fear because some people were targeted and they didn't know necessarily why, or they found very little evidence of actual disloyalty in almost all cases. All right, there were some that were correct. All right, so you get into McCarthyism and you talk about either one of you, have you ever read or seen the McCarthy trials?
I have not.
Okay. Have you heard about them? Okay. Yeah, McCarthy was in Congress, and he accused multiple people, hundreds of people, of being disloyal, right? Or being communist, or, doing all of these things, treasonous acts, or engaging in these treasonous acts. So it started out with him accusing 205 state employees, okay? And then it went to 57, this list went to 57, then the list went to 10, okay? But he never actually released the names. And so there were a lot of accusations, but not a lot of follow-through and not a lot of facts that ever tie the two together, okay? So he had backed up on Richard Nixon's speech, who you'll see becomes even more political as we progress, right? And so you have this not only this fear within the government, but you have this fear within the population of the United States. And then your McCarran Internal Security Act was about a quota system, maintaining the quota system of the number of people from Southern Europe, Eastern Europe, Asia in coming in. Okay, so you have the quotas. All right, and then 52 elections. Truman's approval rating had sunk to 23%, which was the lowest one at that time ever for a president. But it was all about Korea and bribery and communism, right? So Truman is up. Adlai Stevenson is going to run for the Democrats, and they bring in Ike, okay, Dwight D. Eisenhower, to run. And he and Nixon, his running mate, were termed as unbeatable, right? So he had a warm, authoritative personality. You know, he served in World War II, and he was a general. So he pledged to go to Korea and end the stalemate, okay? When he did that, he won. He had 442 electoral votes. He won in a big way. And so as he's coming in. He's being elected. McCarthy, he looks at McCarthy and he thinks that McCarthy's going to hang himself, and he lets him. And so McCarthy, I'm not talking literally hanging himself, I'm talking Joseph McCarthy, continues with his investigations, but they start to become televised. And so the way that McCarthy was attacking people was almost over the top for most of Americans. They looked at it and went, this guy's a little out of control. Okay? So
he's got a hint of Trump in him.
Well, I don't know that I would compare McCarthy and Trump. Yeah, I don't know that I would compare them, but that's a great comment. As he's going through these hearings and the evidence just isn't there, the Senate finally censured him 67-22, okay? And so he loses his authority, and you have this modern Republican coming in where they're steering to a moderate course, okay? Trying to unite people again, moderate, instill confidence, okay? But they have this hidden hand behind the scenes that's working to reduce taxes and contain inflation, all right? But keep stimulating the economy. So not unlike any president at any time, because most of the work is behind the scenes, right? But Ike goes in. One of his domestic priorities or accomplishments was the Interstate Highway Act of 41,000 miles, right? And Ike is just, he's just popular. The second election, 1956, he carried, it was another landslide. And here's your censure of Senator Joseph McCarthy. He really, he lost his authority. They finally brought him down December 2 of 1954. So his behavior was described as contrary to senatorial traditions. Okay? But I encourage you to watch proceedings in Congress, because they're very specific. They're very pointed. There aren't a lot of niceties in these hearings. Okay, they're very pointed in you know, I guess trying to get down to business, right? So Ike and Dulles is his, let me move on here. Dulles is also a proponent of the containment policy, and Stalin actually died in 1953, right? So in July of 53, as the armistice starts again at the parallel in Korea, Dulles is looking at never backing down, even at the risk of war, okay? Ike wasn't going to let that happen. So the U.S. did not intervene during the East Germany uprisings of 1953. They did not intervene in Hungary when it fell in 1956, okay? There were multiple things that the United States didn't intervene in that some critics go back and say, well, had they intervened, they would have changed this. Had they intervened, they would have changed that. You know, shoulda, coulda, woulda, you can play that game every day.
That's what I was going to say, shoulda, coulda, woulda.
Yeah.
So that's right. Like us in the Middle East. I mean, you can't, it's a whole, like, most people over there, they don't want to be Americans, you know, and then, so when we go over there and we try and, you know, change everything to the way we do things, it's not always good. So So it's kind of good that he stayed out of everything.
Mm-hmm.
I think.
Yeah. It definitely was a different way of approaching it, right? And every president is a little bit different. So he did work to reduce the possibility of atomic annihilation, which was pretty high because the United States and Russia just keep building, right? Building atomic bombs. And they started building commercial nuclear plants, right? But most of the money went to the military for bombs, for armaments. And in 1955, Ike and the USSR meet in Geneva to talk about a peaceful coexistence, right? But in 1958, Moscow suspended nuclear atmospheric tests, and the United States followed. In 1954, CETO had been signed, the Southeast Asia Treaty Organization, which meant a defense of different countries. So if you signed it, you signed that your country would defend another, okay? So as the Cold War shifts, as this is going on, the Cold War is shifting from Europe, because Europe is already in control, under control, especially Eastern Europe, right? And it's shifting to the Third World. So you get these CIA covert operations. You have a lot of intelligence gathering in 47. And undercover operations that are trying to topple regimes that are friendly to communism. Right? And when you look at these things, you look and you know, you'll be in a discussion about, say, Afghanistan. And you go back and you look at the history of who was supporting whom and where the U.S. money went, you know, or you look at Iraq or Iran, where the United States at one point was supporting Iran, you know, an uprising in Iran. It went the other way. And then the weapons, the United States weapons and such, were being used against the United States after they had supported X previously, right? So as these countries change hands or change power, right, the troubles in the world change, the dynamics change, and the CIA had a lot to do with these covert operations, and, you know, Reagan got in trouble for that, and Ollie North was, some critics say that Ollie North was just a fall guy for that at that time. But you'll continue to see that because it's pretty amazing to see how things come back, right? And then, let's see, what else can I tell you? Okay, 1953, the coup in Iran. We replaced the prime minister but earned the ire of Iranians. That has come back to us again and again since 1953, right? Philippine elections in 53. Guatemala, where mercenaries overthrew the elected communist-influenced regime, right? Guatemala was big when I was a kid. And that wasn't in the 50s. I'm not quite that old. Right? More troubles in the Third World. You've got Vietnam, South Vietnam, anti-communist North Vietnam, communist, the Middle East, Algeria, France is fearing Arab nationalism. Israel, fearing an Egyptian arms buildup. Right? Israel, this new country that was carved out from World War II. The Suez Canal, which was the reason the United States during World War II went with Britain, because Britain was so fearful that their Suez Canal route was going to be cut off and they'd have no oil supply. Right? So as these things pop up, the United States either sends military aid, troops, covert operations, money. So it's developing a pattern here of going in and supporting anti-communism, right? And then Eisenhower, national security, where the military and the arms was just phenomenal. But also the economy was good. And one of the reasons is because so much had been spent on the military, right? So he had technically avoided war, right? But there was no lasting peace in sight. So in the last slide I have here, and I'm sorry that it's blurry, but this is in Eastern Europe, and it's a traffic sign. So you have a round circle, you have a picture of a tractor on the top, and a horse and buggy on the bottom. Okay? These, in 2009, were current traffic signs. Okay? So, remnants of the... Yeah. It's pretty amazing. I mean, you go into Eastern Europe, and it is a time machine. You are going back to the Cold War. It is all concrete. It is all stark. It is all old. Infrastructure is... I mean, you're totally stepping back in time. It's amazing. I highly recommend Eastern Europe.
Like going to South Africa or, you know, somewhere in the continent of Africa.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's probably even more dramatic. Okay, so 27, mid-century, the GI Bill, demobilization. Do you guys have any questions? Okay.
I turn my mic on when I do.
Okay. All right. So, home alive in 45. Americans want their troops home. Okay? In 1945, there were 12 million troops. In 1948, 1.5 million troops. Okay? So they were bringing guys back. There was, an adjustment period. Anytime somebody goes to war, you come back, everything has changed. You have changed. Your family's changed. Your situation has changed. You know, just keep snowballing that effect, right? So, there's a higher divorce rate. There's a housing shortage. These guys actually have some money. And they're able to buy houses. They're also able to go to school. With the GI Bill, they're able to go into college. And so, by 1947, over 50% of students in the colleges were veterans. They also got job priority. Today they get a job priority. Like if you apply for a federal job and you're a vet, you get extra points on your application.
My sister was in the Army and she was a military intelligence and she was sent to Iraq, but she chose to, I think it was, they were given $40,000 for people to enlist back in the 2002. My brother had enlisted in 2000 and he could get the GI Bill. And have you seen all the abuses of the GI Bill of the colleges lately?
No, I haven't kept up with that.
Yes, you have schools like University of Phoenix Online, or you have, you know, Everest College Online, or just these different colleges, and people don't realize, instead of giving you a diploma, you get, or a degree, you are taking, like, you end up with just a certificate.
Right.
It's pretty bad, though.
Yeah, and there is a problem not just with GIs and vets, but private universities and the federal government's looking at eliminating financial aid. They're scrutinizing financial aid to some of these private universities because they charge so much and you get so little in some cases. In some of these studies is what they're trying to prove or disprove. So, yeah, good point.
That's good because, you know, there's just some people that are still naive and they don't realize, you know, because you have salesmen selling, you know, like I always told my daughters, I was like, if you see a college, you know, on commercials or on advertising, you don't want to go to that college because, you know, they're trying to sell themselves and the college shouldn't have to do that.
Right. So it is, it's a big problem, and they are trying to address it right now. At this time, less women were allowed in because they needed to, the GIs got preference. And so even when women weren't allowed in, it democratized education more so because these GIs were able, and some from lower and some from middle class, but a lot from the lower class, where they were able to go to college and graduate with skills to bump them into the middle class. Okay, so it had a tremendous impact on the society. Okay, so you've got this economic boom starting in 45. One of the reasons is because there was a huge corporate tax cut. All right, so corporations were investing more, creating a new economic boom. And the Bretton Woods Agreement was an agreement for U.S. exports, right, to sell to the Allies and to set the U.S. economy as a world leader in this non-communist world. All right, so they started the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank. Very instrumental in economic development, but also very critical, especially in third world nations, where third world nations aren't able to repay these debts. Okay? So, sizable exchange rates using the U.S. dollar is what the International Monetary Fund is setting up, and the bank itself was used to help rebuild Asia and Europe. Okay? Now, the bank is still being used, right? So as we're moving through this economy and we've created these allies, and not created allies, but created these economic systems, our exports are at record level. And so we are booming, okay? You've got a science, you've got technology, we're almost at the top here in the world because our economy's good. So the new industrial society, you have the book The Affluent Society, and it talks about the American dream and prosperity, where think about it, the gross national product went up 50%. That's incredible. Those are incredible numbers, right? You have people, 60% of people who are now homeowners. That was not possible, okay? In many cases, was not possible until now. Federal spending was driving some of this economic growth, and federal spending nearly doubled in the 50s, right? So the spending of the gross percentage of the gross national product, the federal spending, equaled 1% in 1929. By 1950, it equaled 17%. So your federal dollars are bumping back into the economy and are a huge portion of the economy now. And the West is growing. Science is growing. government is paying for science, and they're doing research, and they're building nuclear plants and developing chemicals, and electricity tripled. I mean, it just is keeps increasing technology and industry to keep up, right? Especially with computers. You know, you went from the first computer in 1944, and by the mid-60s, there were over 30,000 computers. Now, I remember when I was in college, I remember the first computer in our entire dorm. Now, you and Nicholas have a computer on your phone, right? And so you carry it everywhere. My friend Tom was the first person in our entire dorm of several hundred students who had a computer, a personal computer. So that was only 25 years? So it continues to grow by leaps and bounds. But this is when Silicon Valley started and Stanford really became a major part of that. Boston Route 128, Austin, some of these areas around the country that were developing it. But as you develop, big business gets bigger, right? You've got funds that are now in the billions. These firms have assets in the billions. They'd been given extra support during the war, and now they continue to build, right? But as you're building, you're not innovating as much. You are still innovating, but you've got this conformity, not individualism, right? But you're still building technology, just not every person doing something different, right? And this is when, in 1956, the white collar outnumbered the blue collar. And suburbia became popular. As people became more affluent, they could move out. They could buy a house. Where could you buy a house? Well, you could buy a house in the suburbs. And you could buy one there because it was affordable. Because they were ticky-tacky houses. Or pillbox houses. They all looked alike. They were big developments. Still see that today. It goes on all the time. One of the things that makes a debt collector's left eye twitch is the debt that began in the 50s. The American total debt tripled in the 50s. And thrift and savings was no longer vogue. Spending was vogue. So you are it was driving the economy. Remember, we were already a consumer economy. You couldn't buy anything during the war. So now you had money and you're like, wow, I want that. I want a refrigerator. I want a washing machine. Right? And you could buy it. So why not? Right? It was like that never-ending cycle. Hey, that's really cool. And then you have all of the ads talking about the same thing, right? Radio ads and TV ads. They're, you know, hey, everybody has this refrigerator. Look at this cool refrigerator. It's not unlike today. I mean, look at toys for kids. Kids all want the same toy. Adults are the same. Adults all want a great, great car, right? So, auto sales went up. 58 million cars.
58 million cars.
Yeah. You can buy now and pay later. So, Diners Club was started in 1950. That was the very first credit card in the United States. Okay? And you are now spending just bucket loads of money. Okay? And it's fueling
this migration. It's the largest migration time in American history. Because people are moving to where they can buy houses. They're moving to where they have these new cool jobs. Right? So 20 million people moved. And some of them moved, like, far away. You get these enclaves of people who never leave, like, a 10-mile radius, right? Their whole family never leaves a 10-mile radius. And then you get some families who are spread out all over the nation. That would be a fascinating PhD project.
Right? Oh, yeah.
So, the West, because it was empty, I use those terms lightly, right? The West had been so quickly developed that people had moved out there, but then some of their relatives were like, hey, that looks good. Some of their friends said, hey, that looks good. Let's move to the Sun Belt where it's, oh, I don't know, 80 in December instead of 20 below, 50 below in December, right? So you have these different population shifts, and you've got this consensus and conservatism that is coming up. So not everyone is conformed. You have this consumerism that is driving the fact that, well, everybody should have a refrigerator, right? Everybody should. And in that way, they're saying that people are conforming and that. So you've got this decade now, a time of political passivity, and this personal gain becomes your focus, right? Because it can be. You have disposable income. You don't have to think about where your next dollar's coming. Right? Or think of the Dust Bowl, where if you're going to be able to get one plant that grows. Okay? So these are dramatic drawings of the growth of the Sun Belt and how the population increased so dramatically and where. Right, and here you have the primary source for the National Interstate and Defense Highways Act of 56. And this authorized the building of highways throughout the nation. It was the largest public works project in the nation's history. All right, so togetherness, baby boom. In 1957, the number of children per family was 3.2 average. In 2009, it was 1.89. Okay? But in 1945, it was 2.4. So 1945 is 2.4, 1957 is 3.2. Baby boom, right? Baby boomers were born from 46 to 64, 76 million people. Millennials just passed the baby boomers in population. You've got millennials born between 82 and 2000, 83.1 million. Okay? Now think of how impactful the baby boomers were to the economy, to the family, to every aspect of life. And then think of the millennials and how they will impact life, okay? Because they are major political forces, right? And so we're going to get cut off soon. Benjamin Spock, Common Sense Book of Baby and Child Care, was a brand new thought process in raising kids. Okay?
I remember that book.
Yep. My mom had that book.
My mom too.
Yeah. So, marriage and parenthood and education for women, were being promoted. Now, was it being glorified, or was it being constrained, the women's role? You know, you can look at these two different ways. If you read the book Lean In, it talks about women and the fact that as we come into women's rights, especially in the 70s, how that changes, and then how some believe that women didn't take as much advantage of all of the work that the women did in the 70s. But you have the women in the 50s and 40s who are working in a different different light, aren't they? Okay? So, we're going to stop right here, and we'll meet again on Tuesday.
What day is our final in this class?
It's on the syllabus. I want to say it's the 29th. Let me see if I can get it real quick before we get cut off. It is 26th.
I will not be here Thursday the 21st.
Thursday the 21st. Okay. We'll need to make arrangements because there's an exam on that day, too.
I can come in early on, like, Tuesday, or I can just come in another time, whatever.
Sure. Okay. But it's very important to be here on the 26th.
It's very important to be here on the 26th.
See you Tuesday.
Okay, I'll see ya. Have a good weekend.
Okay, I'll see you. Bye-bye.